Hey y'all, Pastor Chip here from CBSM, the Capshaw Baptist Student Ministry. I do this Q&A video every week now, trying just to encourage our students to continue to think, to ask questions, and just to process through the faith that they are learning here at Capshaw Baptist Church and Capshaw Baptist Student Ministry every week. Last night we had a phenomenal night of worship. Just an incredible job that the band did. Last night we had just over 100 students here. We had a special prayer time for some of our students who believe they've been called into the ministry full-time as missionaries or senior pastors or youth pastors or executive pastors or whatever it is. So many of our students came up and said, hey, would you just pray for me? I'm either considering this or I really believe that I have been called to do it. So I'm so thankful for them, what God's doing in their lives. Talked last night about 1 Chronicles 10 through 29, specifically Chronicles 16, about thankfulness and how ginormous this idea of thankfulness is in the Bible. The Bible says that our giving of thanks to God is His will. The Bible says that if we don't give thanks to God, it's an evidence of an unregenerate, unbelieving, unchristian heart. The Bible says that Jesus gave thanks. The Bible says that we will give thanks for all of eternity. But I believe most importantly, the Bible says that the center of our thankfulness should be the person of Christ. He is what we are most thankful for. You can check it out on MP3 here on the blog. Here's some questions that we had for our questions, for texting in questions from our teenagers. Question number one said, Pastor Chip, you said last night during the worship service that God's love never ends, which is true from 1 Chronicles 16. God's love never ends. So the question is, this person asked, does God even love us in His wrath? Well, I think it depends on what they mean that God loves us in His wrath. First of all, God never has any wrath against a Christian. There is no condemnation for those who are found in Christ, Romans chapter 8. We are at peace with God if we're a Christian. There's no wrath whatsoever. We are good to go, and we're fine. So the question is, who does God have wrath against? Well, obviously, God has wrath against unbelievers. But God does not only hate unbelievers, He also loves unbelievers at the same time. It's a paradoxical emotion. God can simultaneously, eternally and infinitely love someone, but at the same time, He also can have wrath and have hatred against them. Psalm chapter 5, verses 5 through 6 says, so, does God still love us in His wrath? If you're an unbeliever, if people that you know are unbelievers, yes. God does still love them in His wrath. But there will be a day that He will have no more love and no more patience and no more tolerance, but He will throw them into hell if they do not come to Christ. His love will be done, and He will only have wrath left for them in an eternal fiery hell. That was a great question. Second question. How do I tell my parents that I've been called into full-time ministry? How do I tell my parents? This teenager came up to me and they said, I feel like I've been called to be a missionary into full-time ministry. How do I go about telling my parents? I said, number one, you need to pray for the perfect opportunity. This is big. This is something that is huge that you're telling them. You believe that God is calling you to give your life, your vocation, your job, your profession, your ministry totally over to Him. So this is absolutely huge what you're doing here. So I would pray for the perfect opportunity over the next 2 or 3 days. I would not put it off. I would do it as quickly as possible. And I would say, God, would you give me the perfect opportunity to tell them in the next 2 or 3 days? And then I would encourage that teenager to do it as gently, as humbly, as respectfully, and as lovingly as possible, asking prayer from their parents, asking their parents questions, asking their parents, do you see the same thing in my life? What are some things that I need to work on? What do you think about your kid being in the ministry? Coming humbly, gently, lovingly, and respectfully, but also praying about it so that you know that's the time that God has ordained for you to tell your parents that you believe that God has called you into ministry. Question number three. This came through on a text message. The question was, if I am dating, if I have a boyfriend or a girlfriend that does not believe in Jesus, should I break up with him? Great question. Love the question. I think the question really here is saying, Pastor Chip, give me some freedom here. Give me some direction. Tell me that I just need to cut it off and that I need to be done. Yes, 2 Corinthians chapter 6 says that we are not to be unequally yoked in any binding relationships with unbelievers, especially when you're supposed to see eye to eye on things in faith, like love. Like how to raise kids, like where to go to church. The people who you date will be the people who you marry. Yes, teenagers, it's okay. You're supposed to break up with them. It's over. Poof, be gone. Kick them to the curb. Whatever it is you got to do. Get out of the relationship if they don't believe in Jesus, if they're not following Jesus, if they're not a part of a church somewhere. It says that there is no commonality between light and dark. If you think about how there's no commonality between light and dark, even more so there's no commonality, 2 Corinthians 6 says, between Jesus Christ and false demonic gods. And that's his point. There's no commonality, so we should not share a common bond like romance and love and dating and relationships and marriage with them either. Should you break up with them? Not only should you break up with them, you should do it now. Right now. Okay, next question. What kind of things, this teenager asked, what kind of things should I be doing to prepare myself for the mission field later on or even now? So this teenager believes that she has been called to the mission field to be a missionary. What kind of things, how should she be preparing for this incredible lifelong ministry? First of all, I believe she needs to be growing in her knowledge of the Word of God. Reading the Word of God. If you're a guy, if you're a girl called to ministry, this is what you need to be doing. Having an unbelievable knowledge of God's Word, because people will be coming to you. And right now, you're learning what you need to know. Secondly, you need a passion for Christ. And these are not in order. I'm just pulling them off the top of my head. You need a passion for Jesus Christ. You need to love Christ. Because if you're going to sacrifice your love for Christ, or sacrifice your life for Christ, then you need to love Christ with this burning, passionate love that you would do anything for him. Because on the mission field, he will call you to do anything when it comes down to it. You need a passion, a love for Christ's church. You need a compassion for the gospel. You need a habit of prayer. You need to pray and ask God to keep you from sin and to keep you from harm. And how you prepare is not only in all of these ways, but also call some missionaries. Find some missionary friends. Go online, email them, read biographies and autobiographies of missionaries. Go on as many mission trips as you can. Talk to your youth pastor, your pastor. Try to link up with missionaries on Facebook. Pray for them. Go on mission trips. Whatever you need to do, make it happen. Prepare yourself. Let the Holy Spirit do it through your word, through his word, and let him do it in your heart as you prepare in these type things. Next, second to last question. What do I do if I'm a Christian, but I just can't seem to give up worldly things because I'm too scared of what people might think of me? I would go straight to the Bible. Psalm chapter 1 says that we do not need to walk in the counsel of the ungodly. We don't need to stand in the way of sinners, stand and just wait for them to hang out with us. We don't need to sit in the seat of mockers, becoming one of them around people that are God haters, if they say it or if they don't say it. Instead, our delight needs to be in the law of the Lord, the scriptures, and we need to meditate, we need to think, we need to process, we need to pray through God's law day and night. If someone is struggling, if you are struggling with being with the wrong people, even though you want to live your life for God, get into the Word of God. Let the Word of God show you what you need to do in order to live for Jesus Christ. Read passages like 1 Thessalonians 2 verse 4. Read passages, I've got a few other ones down here, like Matthew chapter 13, talking about the things of the world, and when the seed of the gospel is planted and people fall away because of things in the world, let that warn you. Think of passages like 1 John chapter 2, verses 14 through 16. think of those, because it's talking about how if you have the love of the world, then the love of the Father is not in you. Let those passages warn you. Let those passages counsel you. Let those passages grow you in your love for Christ and the people of Christ, and that you are more concerned about what God thinks of you than what other people think of you. Lastly,